Kumar, who's an MP, who's a member on that standing committee on home affairs, which has actually been making suggestions about the criminal laws and the new bills that have actually been, or the new sanhitas that have been put back into parliament. But Sudhirji, thank you so much for joining us. But before I
My
ask you
pleasure.
about the bills themselves and what criminal law does, the incident that happened in parliament, I just wanted to get the sense of from you and how have parliamentarians reacted to that breach in security that we've just seen in parliament?
Vikram ji, it's extremely concerning. Members cutting across party lines have expressed their deep concerns. It's a serious breach. We are often told that there's a seven-layer security in the parliament premise. But what happened on the 13th of December is a grim reminder of the fact that the security arrangements were not foolproof, and there should be a thorough investigation, thorough review of the security arrangement. And I hope that such an incident is not repeated. We shudder to think, had there been cyanide or some other poisonous gas in that gas canister, imagine what would have been the consequence, or if there were RDX in the gas canister. So this is very, very concerning, Vikram ji. Hope good sense prevails. But as I see, it could be a blessing in disguise. This could lead to thorough revamp of our security apparatus.
And of course, the fact that this happened at all, because you're right, there's supposed to be really intense security, and how they got the pass, how they were able to come inside, how they smuggled in canisters in their shoes. You're right, it could happen again.
Yeah, this is why, this is why I don't want to make it political, but I really hope that the government takes extreme, which I think they have taken extreme note of it. And as I said, there could be a silver lining to this. This could lead to a complete revamp of the entire security arrangement, not only the parliament, but in every sensitive installation in the country.
All right. Let me change turn my attention now to the new Sanhita. So the fact that the criminal laws needed to be changed, they go back hundreds of years, is something which was very clear cut. What were the standing committee's main views on these new Sanhitas, and were there any other changes that you think may still come via amendments or other such systems?
So Vikram ji, there were a couple of key objectives behind these three new bills. As you rightly pointed out, the original bills date back to 100, if not more, 100-150 years. IPC 1860, Evidence Act 1872, CRPC originally was 1861, then had a revamp in 1973. So most of the provisions in these bills were of the colonial era, and they were not in tune with our modern legal framework. So there was a need to overhaul the entire criminal justice system, particularly in the context of the technological advancements, in the context of the reality of the congestion of Indian courts. Today we have over 60,000 cases pending in the Supreme Court, over 4.5 crore cases pending our trial courts. So these are humongous numbers. And also the fact that Supreme Court and many law commissions and other commissions have time and again pointed out that our criminal justice should be reformative rather than being punitive. So these were the key objectives behind bringing these three criminal law reforms.
But one of the questions, I guess, which I'm sure the standing committee also looked at is, as you correctly said, if you look at the real problem in the Indian criminal justice system, it is pendency, of course, a large number of cases, but above all, delays. The fact that you can have a, it could be you could be investigating a crime for decades before an FIR is filed or a charge sheet is filed. Trials last for decades altogether. People languish in jails as under trials for years before they are suddenly proved to be innocent. That crucial problem of delay, it's probably the single most important reform measure that India has to still deal with. How will these new bills and the amendments help in that?
I think you have hit the nail on the head, Vikram ji. I have been a strong advocate of completely reforming our judicial system and our criminal justice system. I do not claim that these new bills have taken care of all of this with regards to pendency of cases and clogging of our courts, but some efforts have been made. I can give you a couple of examples. Now, previously, there was no time limit as to when a magistrate could pronounce the judgment after the hearing is over. Today, the magistrate is, as per the new law, mandated to pronounce the judgment within 30 days after the hearing is over. Previously, the time limit for the framing of charge was not there after the issue was taken up by the court. Today, it's 60 days. Previously, there was no limit as to how many adjournments the lawyers could take. Of course, it was the discretion of the court, but easily, I'm a lawyer myself, and easily the court granted four or five adjournments to every lawyer. I guess there is some improvement in this aspect, but certainly more needs to be done.
So just looking at the things that have that could, for example, be done. I know that industry, for example, has been pushing for a long time to say you should have things like a statute of limitations. You can't keep things going forever. There has to be a time limit, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, after which you say you've not been able to take cognizance of the case. The case should be dropped. This should be applied to old matters also. Surely all IOs can be encouraged to look at, their cases that are piled up on the courts. If something is 30 years old or 25 years old, or in some cases, God forbid, 40 years old, should just be done away with so we can focus on important cases.
Vikramji, while we are discussing this, I must also add that yesterday, sorry, the day before yesterday, Rajya Sabha passed the repealing and amending bill 2023. This is in addition to the Jan Vishwas bill, which was passed during the monsoon session of the parliament, and I was also part of the Joint Parliamentary Committee, JPC, which looked into the Jan Vishwas bill. Both of these bills are extremely commendable in the sense that they have done away with many, many obsolete and outstanding laws that remain in our statute books. I mean, there were many laws, many legislations, which were actually funny, which were actually amusing. And thanks to this government, if there is one thing which I would like to compliment this government for, it is the fact that they have really taken the effort, made the effort to remove some of these very, very archaic, obsolete old bills.
A lot of what is there in the Sanitas is forward-looking. But do you think whether it's the Jan Vishwas bill or the new Sanitas, whether should some of it be backward-looking also, so that those old cases, the pendency of cases can be reduced to some extent?
One of the aspects of our justice system is that any law can only apply prospectively. It cannot apply retrospectively. So for all the pending cases, these bills, I'm afraid, will not apply even when they come into effect. But I think the fact that technology has been given a lot of prominence, usage of technology in dispensing justice has been given prime importance in the in, under these new bills. I think that will really help us to reduce dependency. Technology has penetrated pretty much every aspect of human life, except for the legal fraternity. It's the last frontier. So to that extent, I think these bills are really forward-looking.
There's some concern about some of the bills that are still there. UAPA, for example, PMLA, some of these bills which are have got very harsh provisions, right, which are capable of being misused. A lot of human rights and other activists have expressed concern about that. Do you share that concern? And how do you make sure that there are laws that are stringent enough to take care of things like terrorism or sedition? For example, in the terror definition now, economic security has also been added. Now, there'll always be concern that can it be possibly misused? Somebody doing, you're not paying your taxes. Is that attacking the economic security of India? So suddenly a terror clause is put into some FIR or charge sheet somewhere. How do you prevent that abuse?
Certainly any law could be misused for that matter. Why only the three bills or PMLA or UPA? I actually welcome the fact that terrorism has been included in the BNS because there was no definition of terrorism in the IPC. But the first version of BNS had terrorism defined very, very vaguely. So the committee had given its recommendation that this is an extremely wide and vague definition. This should be made very specific, which the second version that was introduced in Lok Sabha 2 3 days ago has taken care of. Now, why I say I welcome this? Because you had state-specific laws. For instance, Maharashtra had the Moka Kaya. You had the UP Act, the Gunda Act, and but you didn't have a central act to take care of terrorism or organized crime. Now you had instances where criminals could commit offense in the state with a state-specific act, and then move to a state with doesn't have a similar legislation. So it was extremely difficult for the law enforcement agencies to handle such cases. So this is why there was a need for a central act.
Okay, I'm going to now get into the subject in slightly more detail. And there's a reason for this. You know, you've heard from us on the India story. So many reforms have been done. So many positive things have been done. But fixing the judicial system to some extent, speeding it up, reducing pendency, perhaps the single most important item on the reform agenda. And that's why on the India story, we're going to keep coming back to this theme. Two really special experts now joining us.